I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight?
Welcome to Detroit Worship Center. We hope you enjoy today's message presented by Pastor Sharice Jabert. And now, here's Pastor C.
God, and he reveals what's going on in the heavens, and he reveals what's going on in the spirit realm, and that will not be allowed, and God is not allowing it to stay in this place. And so we thank God for the worship in this place this morning. Amen. We thank God for the worship. I thank God that you came here ready to worship. Amen. Ready to worship, ready to hear from God. And so we're going to go ahead and get started. I'm excited about the word of God today. And even though we've been talking about a culture on the west location, and we just kind of came here on the east location, I want to go ahead and pick up. If you've not watched, if you've not been a part of any of the services, and you've not watched for the last 6 weeks, I believe it is, I've been talking about the Exodus 35 culture. That is a culture where we are stirred by the heart of God. Our hearts are stirred by the word of God, by the spirit of God, to go forth and to do the things that God has for us to do. There's so much work to be done here in the kingdom. There's so much work to be done on the east side. There's work to be done on the west side. There's work to really be done everywhere. Amen. And so I thank God and praise God for his example in Exodus 35. And that example in Exodus 35, if you haven't read it, please take the time to read it. It's a period of time where the Lord spoke to the men and the women of the Lord. He spoke to them through their leader, and then he spoke to their hearts individually. And so when we say that we're in Exodus 35 culture, we're in Exodus 35 culture where we allow the Spirit of God to minister to us, not fear, not intrepidation, not manipulation, but being motivated by the Spirit of God. And so I think it's so important. Really, this past week, Chloe and I had an opportunity. We went away on a planning and prayer trip, really locking down the calendar for 2018 and locking down the rest of the calendar for 2017, just hearing from God on what he wants to say and what he wants to do for the entire year. And so we did that, and we actually went away. We think, why in the world would you go to a place like this? But God sent us to Las Vegas. And when we were there, we could feel in the atmosphere more than ever before. And I've been before, but you can feel in the atmosphere people were open and ready to hear from God. And because of the tragedy that took place and because of everything that happened, and we were in our timeshare at the very end of the strip, away from all of the extra stuff, and we were not too far from the hotel. I actually saw the windows that were still broken out from the gunman that was up there. And so everywhere you went on the street, when we first got there on Monday, and so there were still lines of people giving blood all over the city. And there were people, you know, we were in a Lyft driver's car probably every single day, and they said it was so chaotic that Lyft drivers were just giving people a ride anywhere they needed to go. They would just pick people up the street because people were running mad everywhere. And so you could sense that more than ever before that they were open to the things of God. They were open to hear from God. And so we took the time not just to plan for DWC, but we took the time to pray for those in the city of Las Vegas who had experienced loss and those who had come from out of state just to a concert who had experienced loss. So I encourage you to continue to pray for those family members who experienced, you know, their family members passing away as a result of what took place in Las Vegas. But I have to tell you that the culture of DWC is such that we don't just care about ourselves, we care about other people. Right? We don't just care about ourselves, we care about other people. It's not just something we see on TV, or it's not just something. Our hearts are stirred when we see need, when we see the Spirit of God lacking. The very culture of DWC is such that we're an Exodus 35 culture. We allow the Spirit of God to touch our hearts, to move our hearts, not just so we can feel a certain way, but so that we can go out and help other people. Amen. We should be compelled to go out and help other people. The Bible says that the Great Commission, and I talked about that several weeks ago, is to go out. It's to go out. That means I have to leave where I am and go somewhere else. It's to go out and to not only teach and make disciples, but he says, I want you to bring them into me, and then I want you to model before them the right way, and the right way to be, and the right way to live. And so, again, just kind of bringing it all together from all the different weeks. If you've not been with us, we've been talking about the Genesis, the Exodus 35 culture. We've been talking about the necessity and the importance of having a strong culture. And a few weeks ago, I gave you a small petri dish. How many of you got those petri dishes last time? I almost brought some this week. I'll bring some more next week if you did not get one. And so the significance of that petri dish is for you to understand and know how a culture develops, how culture grows. And I wanted you to take that petri dish home, and I wanted you to sit down and talk with your family members about how your culture is developed in your own home. Because it's very, very important to know that your culture at home should be aligned with the culture at church. And it shouldn't be aligned with the culture at church so that we don't bring any strains in here that cause toxicity. We don't need to bring any strains in here that cause toxicity. That means that if we're all living by the Word of God and we're all doing the things that God has said, when you bring your culture to this culture, it should all flow together. Amen? It should all flow together. And so this word today, you know, I have to tell you, those of you, how many of you were here last week? How many of you were here last week? How many of you were not here last week? Let me say that. We're not here. Okay. Well, last week was our first Sunday in the East Side. Amen? And so we talked about the significance of it being our first Sunday. And I said three things that God was doing. It's a prophetic word. It's a word that has not gone away. Because the Bible says that the Word of God is always relevant. It's always current. It says it's sharper than a two-edged sword. It's living and it's quick. So just because there was a prophetic word last week doesn't mean it's canceled out for this week. And so the prophetic word last week was this, that God is doing something supernatural in this time of visitation. And when we came into this building, it was a manifestation of what God is doing. Number one, we said there was a divine exchange that took place as a result of us coming to this place. We said there was a distribution of spoil that took place, and then there's a delineation of power and authority. So I'm going to give you a very, very brief review, and then we'll get started with our new lesson today. Isaiah 61, if you have your Bible turned to Isaiah 61, Isaiah 61. You know, obviously it's a powerful, all the word is powerful. And Isaiah 61, I'm not going to read it all, but verses 1 through 11 is a very, very significant scripture, especially for what we're doing in ministry and what we're doing in DWC today. I'm going to read the first couple of scriptures. It says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord has anointed and commissioned me to bring good news to the humble and afflicted. He has sent me to bind up the wounds of the brokenhearted, to proclaim release from confinement and condemnation to the physical and spiritual captives, and freedom to prisoners, to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance and retribution of our God, to comfort all who mourn, and to grant those who mourn in Zion the following, to give them a turban instead of dust on their heads, or a sign of mourning, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and the garment of expressive praise instead of a disheartened spirit. So they will be called the trees of righteousness, strong and magnificent, distinguished for integrity, justice, and right standing with God, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. And so he talked about the significance of the divine exchange taking place and how God has blessed us to be in this place, and that it's not just an acquiring of a property. It's not just an acquiring of a building. It's the occupation of a presence that God has given us in this community. It's the occupation of an assignment that God has given us in this community. It's not just a building. Somebody say it's not just a building. It's not just a building. And you have to know and understand that who is the church? We are the church. The building is not the church, but we are the church. And so as we occupy this building and we occupy it with the Spirit of God, we can expect God to do some great and mighty things here in this community. Amen? And so so it's very, very important for us to keep in mind the divine exchange. The divine exchange I talked about was that the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the righteous. I talked about the distribution of spoil. And then again, I talked about the delineation of power and authority. The distribution of spoil, we talked about the battle belonging to the Lord. We talked about the necessity and the understanding that when we are in a situation where there is a fight that is taking place, a faith fight that is taking place, the only thing that we use to fight with is our faith. That God has instructed and commanded that we hold still and allow Him to fight our battles. And then the delineation of power and authority. We know that God is causing all of us to be known as true priests of the Lord, meaning that people will see and understand and know that it's not in our words, but it's in power demonstrated that the Spirit of God rests and rules and manifests here. What makes one church different from another? The power of God. That's what makes one church different from another. There are churches on every corner out here. There are churches on every corner, almost everywhere you go, at least within a 2 or 3 mile radius. Well, what makes one different from the other is the fact that the power of God resides in some and not in others. And then the authority of the Lord resides in some and not in others. And so what's the difference between power and authority? Well, power comes from God. Yes, power comes from God. And authority comes from God. But authority is how you walk in that power as given by God. It's how you walk in that power is given by God. And so it's a very, very powerful thing when you have somebody that can walk in authority, when you have people that can walk in authority, when you have people that walk in authority, and that's the culture we're building here in Exodus 35, you can expect that you walk down the street and you see someone sick, and the authority of Jesus Christ is on you to call out that thing and to call healing to the body of that person. You can expect that because you walk in authority. You can expect that if you're going down a dark alley and someone comes your way that looks like they're not the right kind of person, that the Spirit of God dwells on the inside of you and you can apprehend that person even without a weapon. That's authority. That's authority. See, sometimes people think that they get so comfortable in their own security of natural things. Of natural things. And God wants us to get to a place that Exodus 35 culture says, no, no, no. My heart is stirred up on the inside. My spirit is stirred up on the inside because of who I am in the Lord and who God is in my life. And because of that, I really don't have any boundaries that prevent me from moving forward in the things of God. It doesn't mean that I'm all willy-nilly, I'm not submitted to anybody, but what it means is that I have the power of God on the inside of me. I'm going to walk in what He says I can walk in, and nothing and no one will stop me from moving forward. Really, really simple. Really, really simple. Nothing and no one will stop you from moving forward. This is the culture that we're creating. You all know the bishop was a very strong man. Amen. A very, very strong man. Married to a very, very strong woman. So we had a very, very strong household. And you can imagine we had a very, very strong one. So when we lie down on something, we lie down on it. And so when the enemy tries to act up, he doesn't get to go too far because we both lie down on it. Well, I have to tell you that, you know, it's time out for just some of us to be that way. Time out for just some of us to be that way. God is desiring for us to be built into a body where the strength of the Lord is on every single one of you. That the power of God is in every single one of you. That every single one of you goes forth in the authority of the Lord. The authority of the Lord. Not, you know what, I'm going to have this righteous indignation and I deserve this. And because I'm a child of God, I get to do that. No, no, no. I'm talking about my life is ordered. My life is ordered to the degree that I have a spiritual right to deal with things in the heavenlies. And I have a spiritual right to dismantle the schemes of the enemy because I'm living according to the word of God. And so the enemy has to bow. Every knee has to bow, every tongue has to confess that Jesus is Lord. And so everything's got to bow. That means nothing that should not be in your realm of influence, nothing that shouldn't be in your realm or sphere of living should last or stand because of the authority given you. I'll give you an example. One of the things I confess on a regular basis is I say sickness cannot live in my body more than 24 hours. Period. That's what I've been confessing for a very long time. It cannot live in my body longer than 24 hours. You know, if you get in, you get 24 hours and you're out. If you get in. Why do I say that? Because the Bible says that Jesus died on the cross but our sickness and disease was carried to the cross as well. I don't have to receive the actual symptoms that are coming my way. Doesn't mean they aren't real. I don't have to receive them into myself. I don't have to call a disease mine. No, I don't have to call a sickness mine. It doesn't belong to me. It doesn't belong to me. It belongs, nailed to the cross, it belongs to the world. They're the ones that travail. They're the ones who are cursed. They're the ones who, you know, who have to eat the fruit of their labor. They're the ones. No, it doesn't belong to me. And so why do I have a right? Why do I walk in the authority to say that sickness and disease cannot last in my body for more than 24 hours? Because I made a decision that I'm going to live according to the things of God, and I'm going to make sure that this temple can house, that this temple can house the power of the Lord. Now, what does that mean? That means, and I'm getting ahead of myself because I'm so excited, that we are stirred to do 10 things. I'm only going to give you 5 today because I don't have much time. We're stirred to do 10 things, 10 things, many more things, but 10 the Lord really brought my attention to. Stirred. This is an Exodus 35 culture, and the tagline that the Lord gave me was a generation stirred, not shaken. We're not moved by fear. We're not moved by intimidation. We're not moved by manipulation. I'm going to tell you something. Those of you who are connected here at DWC, you will not be intimidated by anyone. You will not be manipulated by anyone. And you will hear the voice not of a stranger to tolerate. Period. Period. That is my prayer over you on a regular basis. So if it happens and somebody else is praying witchcraft prayers over you, somebody is praying or having negative intentions against you, you immediately know that that's not, my pastor has not prayed that over me. So if I'm thinking ways that don't line up with what my pastor has said that she's praying for me, then I know that that must be the enemy. Because I'm learning the voice even more of my shepherd, and because of that, the voice of a stranger I will not follow. So when we hear that voice that is strange, that is strange, that is downing you, that is discouraging you, that is trying to pull you away from the things of God, you know that that is not the voice of your Father, the Good Shepherd. Amen? Yeah. So 5 things, I said 10 things we're stirred to do. Just repeat after me. Say, obey.
Obey.
Please, God.
Please, God.
Distribute resources.
Distribute resources.
Engage my skill.
Engage my skill.
Get mobilized.
Get mobilized.
Become an apprentice.
Be honorable.
Become respectful contributors.
And discerning disciples.
So 5 things. The first 5 things. Number 1, obey. We are stirred to obey. In the Exodus, I didn't say my number 10. My number 10 was become meek learners. Amen. So my number 1 was obedient. Obedient. Titus 3. You just write that scripture down and read it later. Titus 3, 1 through 11. It says, remind them to be subject to rulers, to authorities, to be obedient, to be ready for every good deed, to malign no one, to be peaceable and gentle, showing every consideration for all men. For we also once were foolish ourselves, disobedient and deceived, enslaved to various lusts and pleasures, spending our life in malice and envy and hateful and hating one another. But when the kindness of God our Savior and his love for mankind appeared, he saved us, not on the basis of deeds, which we have done in righteousness, but according to his mercy by the washing of regeneration and renewing by the Holy Spirit. He says, look, I need you, Titus, to remind the people of God to be subject to rulers and authorities. So that means here at DWC, I'm not going to ever tell you that you don't need to listen and do what you've been instructed to do by those that you serve under if it does line up with the word of God. There would not be, what I'm saying, I'll just encapsulate for you. There will not be a rebellious spirit in this house. It will not run wild, and you don't have to worry about there being rebellion. The Bible says rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. And so you don't have to worry about there being rebellion in the house in any form of leadership whatsoever, because I've said it and I've said it again, it will be dealt with. It will be dealt with. So there's not going to be rebellious running red while we're here. He says, remind them to be subject to rulers and authorities, to be obedient, to be ready for every good deed. That means we are to be ready for every good action and good deed and thing that the Lord has given us to do. And so it's important that we know that we have a culture of obedience here. The culture here, now again, when you go home and you look at and you examine your own personal culture, if your own personal culture is not one such that obedience is first and foremost in your life, then you need to go back and re-examine what you need to do in order to obey more quickly than you did before. Sometimes some of us have been in a situation where we've kind of raised ourselves.
We kind of raised ourselves. Maybe your parents were, you know, missing in action. Maybe they were neglectful. Maybe they just kind of did their own thing. And maybe you didn't have someone that kind of led and guided you along the way. Maybe like it should have happened. But you're in a place now where you're under the word of God. You've been under the word of God. And God now holds you responsible to obey him. Not looking at what happened when you obeyed before. Maybe you weren't rewarded for the obedience. We need to know and understand that God's obedience comes with great rewards. Great rewards. Deuteronomy 28, God tells us through scriptures 1 through 14, I believe it is, the blessings of obedience. If you obey God, these are all the things that I will do in your life. And so DWC is a church where we honor obedience. We honor obedience corporately. We honor obedience individually. We honor obedience when we are reminded of this. We will be reminded of this on a regular basis because the Bible says that we trust and obey him. If we trust him, we will eat the good of the land. We will have good lives. We will have lives that are blessed. We will have lives where he promised us in abundance. We will have those abundant lives because we have chosen to be obedient. There's no one here that should be in a situation where, again, I say it again, where we look at the church and see that the church is doing well and moving forward, but we're not moving forward in our own personal lives. That will not happen in DWC because I declare that DWC is a church where you have chosen in your heart to obey God, not just in here, but out there too. Amen? We're going to be God pleasers. Not just obey him, because you can obey him and not please him. You can just do what he says and that's it. You ever have a child and they only did what you asked them to do? They didn't do any extra. No extra. You said wipe the table and there's a crumb that just got to the edge. You said table, not the side of the table. And so God is like, no, wait a minute, you know, God pleaser. You know, I was one of those people where I was a parent pleaser. And I like to just go overboard. I would come home and just reorganize my mom's closet, or I would just go and do whatever because I love pleasing them. I love to see the smile on their face. I love to see those things. They didn't ask me to do those things, but I'd like to please them because I love the joy that it brought them when I did these things that blessed them. We should be ones that are constantly looking to see how can we please God. We just want to see, we want to see his love shown toward us. We want to see his face really just shown toward us and come our way and look our way. We want his countenance to be lit up because of what we have done. We want to be able to be a God pleaser in all that we do. And so I declare that DWC is a place where it's full of God pleasers. Full of people that just want to please God, not pleasing self, not pleasing other people. Remember, we honor God. We'll have our banners up coming pretty soon. But we honor God, we trust man and we honor God. We honor God too, but we trust man not, and we honor God. We trust man not and honor God. Why don't you trust man not? Because we did this whole series on the fear of man brings a snare. And so it's important for us to keep in our mindset that we honor God in all that we do, and we make sure that we don't get into the rut of fearing man. Fearing man will cause you to do a lot of things that you don't want to do. Fear man will cause you to be in a lot of situations where God didn't desire you to be in a place of fear and intrepidation or intimidation, but we are in that place simply because we decided that we were going to fear man. It's important because when we please God, we make some decisions. Romans 8:7-9 says, because the mindset of the flesh is hostile toward God. How often do we think that? When we get fleshly, we become hostile toward God. That means, yeah, when we get in our flesh, we become hostile. For God, hostile. That means vehemently against, opposing, coming against. I mean, he says, look, when you get in your flesh, it's so disgusting. The Bible says in the flesh dwells no good thing. It's so disgusting to him. He says, look, because the mindset of the flesh is hostile toward God, for it does not subject itself to the law of God, it's not even able to do so. The flesh can't even obey. It's the spirit of God on the inside of you that's obedient. So when you see the nastiness that comes out of people, it's not their spirit. It's their flesh. And I declare and decree that DWC members are going to be such that they're not going to walk in their flesh. Not going to walk in their flesh. They're not going to coddle the flesh. They're not going to think that there's a cute thing or a good thing about being in the flesh. Not even for a minute or a moment. It's important that we fix our minds and fix our hearts on being God pleasers. And we cannot please God in the flesh. Cannot. Colossians 1:9-14. It says, since the day we got this good news about you, we have not stopped praying for you. We ask, Father, that they may clearly know your will and achieve the height and depth of spiritual wisdom and understanding. May their lives be a credit to you, Lord. And what's more, may they continue to delight you or please you by doing every good work and growing in the true knowledge that comes from being close to you. That's my prayer. This was the prayer in this chapter. This was the prayer. The Lord, let them know you. Let them please you. Let them please you as they learn of you and understand you more and more and more. And so again, I declare that there are God pleasers in this church, and that it's not just one, it's not just two, but the culture is such that it'll be contagious. It'll be contagious with God pleasers in this place. Hebrews 11:6 says that without faith, it's impossible to please God. And so I declare that your faith is going to go to another level while you're connected here at DWC. Your faith is going to go to another level. Yes, your faith is going to go to yet another level. The Bible says that we should be able to go grow from faith to faith. And so your faith should go to another level. You may think that you maxed out on your faith, but there is no max out in faith. There's no max out in faith, and so you can stand to grow in your faith. I can stand to grow in my faith. And so it's important that we all kind of get an understanding and know that we are going to grow in faith. We're going to grow in faith, and it's a part of pleasing God. Our faith is going to be regularly stoked here at DWC on a regular basis. In every message that is taught, faith is going to be interwoven without it all throughout that message. Amen? 1 Thessalonians 4 says, so finally, brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord Jesus, we ask you, we beg you to remember what we've taught you. Live a life that is pleasing to God as you are already doing. He said, you know, I realize that there's some of you that are already living a life pleasing God. Continue to do it. For those of you who are not, and you know that you're not, I need you to get on the bandwagon of pleasing God. I need you to make sure that you make some concessions in your life, that you please Him, that you stop some things, start some things, rearrange some things, do some things differently so that you can please God. It's so significant when He says that I want you to, you know, that we can delight ourselves in Him and He will give us the desires of our heart. But the Bible also says that, you know, the hope deferred makes the heart sick. So when I put those things together, I think about the fact that, hey, if I delight myself in Him so that He can bless me with the desires that are in my heart, I also need to know that, you know, sometimes hope deferred, that means when I don't have faith, when I just put off my faith in certain areas, it can make my heart sick. So I'm waiting for Him to give these desires of my heart to me, but my faith is not to the level that these things can come. My faith is not to the level that these things can come. I believe, God, that DWC, that you will be a membership that will determine that not only are you going to please God, but you're going to grow in your faith. You're not going to be baby, you know, you're not going to be little fake babies. Right? You're not going to be fake babies. Remember the lesson? Many months ago, you know, you can choose whether or not you go from infant to toddler. And toddler to teen, and teen to adolescent, adolescent to young adult, and mature adult. You can choose to do that based on whether or not you allow God to stretch you in your faith. Sometimes growing your faith is going to require you to stretch. It's going to require you to stretch. That means it's going to feel uncomfortable because you're going to do some things, you're going to say some things you didn't want to say. It may not seem normal to you to speak to your car and command it to run. It may not be normal for you to speak to your finances and command them to be replenished. It may not be normal for you, but the Bible says that we call those things that be what? As though they were. And so it's very, very important to know that we are a faith-based church. And because of that, we're going to do some things that may seem a little bit uncomfortable to you at first if you don't do it on a regular basis. But if you do it on a regular basis, you increase your faith. Every single time you wake up in the morning, you extend your faith and you stretch your faith more and more, you will be amazed at the things that God will do. He's just waiting on you to grow your faith. And we please God with our faith. Pleasing God also means, and I say this, it also means that sanctification and holiness is required. Now, you say, Dr. C, you know, that sounds old. Sanctification and holiness. No, sanctification and holiness are never old. They're never old. They're never old. They're never old. Now, people's perception of what that is, it differs. But the Bible is very, very clear that we should be a sanctified people, a set-apart people. DWC will be a set-apart people. See, you know, when there's peer pressure in a high school or in a place or even groupthink in an organization, and everybody together is pressuring the other one. They all come together and they all think one way, and they're pressuring the other to think another way. You know, and then that person who's not thinking like everyone else has to make the decision. Am I going to put aside my values? Am I going to put aside what I trust to know to begin to believe what they're talking about? You have to determine on the inside of your heart that sanctification is one of those things where you don't care what it may sound like on the outside because it's a biblical the term. You're going to do what God says is required to be sanctified and set apart. And set apart is simply what has the Lord spoken to you to do to set yourself apart so that you do not look like the world. Well, it may be different from you than it is for me. And so we don't need to judge one another and say, well, you know what? He told me not to ever cut my hair. And that person's growing their hair down to the floor. God tells us all, he tells us all what we need, right? To possess our own vessels and to make sure we bring glory and honor to him. And so it's very, very important that we know that sanctification is a huge part of who DWC is. You know, what do I mean by that? And holiness is required, not rigorous rules, just what the word of God says. I'm going to tell you Ephesians 4:17-31. When you get a chance, read Ephesians 4:17-31. It says, so this I say and affirm together with the Lord, that you no longer walk as the Gentiles also walk in the futility of their mind, kind of like the carnal people. He says, look, I need you to not be like the carnal people who walk in the futility of their mind, being darkened in their understanding. He said, they don't understand. Excluded from the life of God because the ignorance that's in them. He said, look, there's a whole kind of God life that these people don't even have access to because they're so carnal. He said, because of the hardness of their heart, they become callous. They've given themselves over to sensuality for the practice of every kind of impurity with greediness. But you did not learn Christ in this way. If indeed you've heard him and have been taught in him, just as truth is in Jesus, then in reference to your former manner of life, you lay aside the old self, which is being corrupted in accordance with the lusts of deceit, that you may be renewed in the spirit of your mind and put on the new self, which is the likeness of God that's been created in righteousness and holiness of truth. All sentences. Okay, those of you who have accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you are now his. Somebody say, I'm now his. You're now his. You're now his. You may have been his back in 1975. You're his in 1980. You might have been his in 1990. Whenever you became his, you are now his. And because of that, he said, look, I set you apart from that day. I set you apart from that day. Now you need to do what you need to do to stay set apart until I come. And so what things set you apart? He says, number one, of course, not walking in the flesh. Number two, not giving in to the lust. That means I don't get to do everything I want to do. That's why do me doesn't work for me. That's why I do, because me is my flesh. And I can do my flesh because the Bible says in my flesh dwells no good thing. So I can't do me. I can't even confess to me. The Bible says that death and life are in the power of my tongue. One of the things we're going to make sure that we do, and it's not legalistic, but we want to make sure that we do, is that we're careful in what we speak so that we don't become what we speak. Because the Bible says, according to what? He said, what did he say about your heart? When a man believeth in his heart, so is he. But what comes into the heart? Where do we lay our heart? Out of the abundance of our heart, our mouth speaks. So he says, look, I need you to know something. If you're going to be sanctified and set apart, I got to watch what goes in my heart. I got to watch what comes out of my mouth. But it's not that difficult, y'all. It's really not that difficult. If you set yourself apart, then you're out of the element that will cause you to put bad things in your heart. If you set yourself apart, you're out of the element that will cause you to have lustfulness in your heart. If you're out of the element that you don't need to be around, you don't have to worry about trying to hold back from stuff. You're in the right place at the right time, all the time. It's really not hard. People are like, oh my God, look, being a believer is really hard. I see everybody else partying. I see everybody else doing this. I see everybody else doing that. And I can't do this or I can't do that. Or the Bible says I kind of can, but it's not the best thing for me, you know. And so you have to come to a place where you say, do I want to be sanctified and set apart? Do I want to, at any point in time, for God to use me? Do I want to be in a position where I give glory to God and I please him because I'm in my right mind at all times, ready to be used by him because I've not been out all night doing stuff I don't know that I need to be doing? So I believe and I confess and I declare and decree that the members of DWC live lives that are sanctified and set apart. Sanctified and set apart. That means if you're not abstinent, you need to get abstinent. Yes. If you're not abstinent, you need to get abstinent. You need to get abstinent. Not because I'm trying to run your life. It's because God loves you. It's because God loves you. And he said, that's what you did there. That's what you used to do. That's what you used to do. He said, that's what you used to do. That's not who you are now. Don't you know that I died on the cross for your sins? Don't you know that I was raised up in power so you can say no? So you can move this way and not that way. Do you understand and know that you don't have to? Now look, You know, I'm a loving person. I'm a forgiving person. We've all made mistakes. We've all messed up. But I'm going to tell you, I love you so much with the love of the Lord that I want you to live a life that's sanctified and set apart so you can get all, not some of the blessings of God. I want you to get all the blessings of God. All of the blessings of God. Don't look at people. This is one of the things I've been teaching for 20-something years. Don't get in the position. The Bible says in Hebrews 6, I believe, in 12, it says, look, don't be slothful, but be imitators of those who through faith and patience inherit the promise. What does that mean to me? And this is the way I've taught it for a long time. That means don't look in awe at the attributes that you see in other people that you admire. You just, oh my God, they're so this. Oh my God, how can they hear from God so quickly when you know that there are things that God told you to sanctify and set yourself apart from? All you, that's what he's saying. He said, don't be lazy and just admire. You need to get up and do. See, admiring someone and flattering someone is laziness to some degree. Because you can just stand afar and admire all the great stuff and never reach it yourself. Never attain to it yourself. And all they're doing is what the Lord God told them to do, and you want to do it in your heart. But on the inside of you, you're saying, you know what, but I just don't want to leave this. I just don't want to stop this. I just don't know what people will say if I move away from this. And so you look and you admire. And so you just level all, you know, just level all this admiration on top of that person for how awesome they are. And I don't know how you have so much self-control. And I guess you do know. They chose to set themselves apart. They chose to go in a place of fasting and prayer to set themselves apart from the things of the world. I'm not saying it's super easy, but all it takes is a decision. All it takes is a decision. And God will take. The Bible says that the word of God, the sword of the Spirit, is so powerful. It can divide asunder your soul from your spirit. That means if your soul is so jacked up, the word of God can slice that thing and dice that thing and get whatever needs to be out. And so I have to tell you, no, I'm not going to kick you out of DWC if you're shouting, right? But what I'm saying is this, you should be of the heart. You should be of the man or woman of God that says, I need to take my faith to another level, and I know being unsanctified and unholy is not going to do it. Now, I did say this, I'm going to close in just a minute and with our confession, and I did say this a couple weeks ago, and the Bible does talk about drinking. Yes. So yes, I'm going to hit that, and I just came back from Las Vegas. The Bible talks about drinking, and the Bible talks about, you know, there's so many different scriptures, and people ask me, I'm from a doctor, so, you know, and you all know our sins, Bishop and I, we don't drink, we didn't drink, and I don't drink, and I don't for a number of reasons. Number one, there's addiction in my family. Right? So number one is not wise. Number two, Number two, the Bible says if you're a priest or even a king, and many of you are either a priest or a king, he says we are, we're prophets, priests, and kings in our household. So everybody in here is a priest, king, or king, priest. Right? And so he says that it's not wise. Why would I want to do something that's not wise? Why would I want to do something that's not wise? I want to present myself to God a living sacrifice, not a tipsy sacrifice, not a buzz sacrifice. I don't want to be a buzz sacrifice. I don't want to be a tipsy sacrifice. I don't want to be a high sacrifice. I don't want to be a high sacrifice. I want to be a sacrifice to the Lord, which is my reason, because it's just reasonable for you to make the distinction between who you want to be and who you were. It's just reasonable. It's reasonable. Come on now. He died on the cross. He endured the cross for us. It's just reasonable that we want to use wisdom. It's just reasonable that we want to stop doing some of the things we do. It's just reasonable. It's just reasonable. It's reasonable. So as I believe God that those of us in here will say, you know what? I want to take my walk to another level. I want us as a body to be in a position that when we, because we are going to hit the streets of the east side, and we are going to hit the streets of your state. Now, what I'm going to say, Bishop is not a door-to-door. Bishop is not maybe on the street. I am. So we will be out in the community. We will be out in the community. He agreed with it, and he pushed for it. We just have a little, you know, we just have different administrations of our gifts. And so we will be out talking to the community. We will be out walking and determining, you know, hey, do you need prayer today? Do you blah, 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 blah. And so we are going to hit, once we get a strategy and a plan, we are going to hit this community. But I need everybody to be sanctified and set apart so that if there's deliverance that needs to take place at the exact moment that God can bring forth the gift, we don't need to tell. Right? We don't need to care. We don't need to be like, man, you know, you cast when I know what you did last night. Right? And so I want us all to go to, I want us all to be in a place where we make a personal decision to please God with everything that's on the inside of us so we can be more fully used by Him to win more people into the kingdom. It's nice for us to come in and we've all been church to some degree and you've been to other churches, but what about the people who've never been to church? This is who we want to bring in. This is who we want to draw in. We want to draw in the sinner. We want to draw in the ones who don't know they need Jesus. And the way that they know the difference between you and somebody goes to another big church down the street is the power and the authority that you walk in. That's what they can tell the difference between the two of you. So we got to come to this place, right? Where we see God, we worship God, but more importantly, that we have a life that pleases God. Amen? Well, I have to tell you that I'm going to close now. I want to give you some more. I really do, because I have the resource distributors who I'll give you next week when we all come together. We'll all be in here together at 10 a.m. 10 a.m. 10 a.m. Y'all got it? Spread the word. It's going to be packed in here, but 10 a.m. We'll probably need to put some more chairs in here, but 10 a.m. we'll be in here. We decided to do a combined service the week before we actually have our first fruit giving, and it'll be a lesson that we will continue in this, but I'm going to really hit resource distributors for next week, and we're going to talk about the significance of distributing our resources. Our resources are not just money, it's our time, our talent, and our treasure. Amen? Amen. So let's stand to our feet. God is a good God. Hallelujah. He loves you so much. He loves all of us so much. And I just want us to just say this confession from your heart, believing God to do the supernatural. I'm going to challenge you, because that's what I'm supposed to do as your pastor. I'm going to challenge you to make some decisions that you may not have made before. Make some decisions you may not have made before. To take your level of sanctification to another level. I'm just going to be upfront and honest with you. Right? Bishop and I have always been upfront and honest. So, how many of y'all like comedy? Comedy, yeah. So, you know, I keep what I call, for the last 25 years, I keep what I call a spiritually clean environment in my house. But I needed to laugh one day. I'm telling y'all, quiet. I needed to laugh one day. I really did. And so why did I turn on Cat Williams? Because he would make me laugh, but he's bad. And so I had to repent. I had to repent before God. I said, Lord, please forgive me for polluting this environment for a laugh. Did I not? Deacon Michelle. She was with me. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to jump on it. But you repented. Right or not? Right. And so, Ella was with me. But did I not go to y'all and say I repented? Then I'm not going to y'all. I said, Lord, I repent. I'm known to keep a spiritually clean environment in my house. And I just jacked that thing up with that for 30 minutes of Cat Williams. So I just said, we all do it. Right? Just repent and move on. Right? I'm not saying I practice it like, hey, okay, I'm going to do it again about 30 days from now. No. I needed to laugh that day. And I said, Lord, I'm sorry that I didn't rely on you to give it to me another way. That was an easy way. I took the easy way out. Amen. So I just have to, that's just the point of transparency. Amen. I'm still saved. I'm still saved. I still love God. Amen. Just say, Father, I thank you for the new wine of DWC and for the new wineskin that I have become. I declare that I'm in the right place at the right time. I declare that I am an obedient son or daughter of the Lord. I please God with my whole life. I'm not stingy, but I distribute resources of my time, talent, and treasure to the advancement of the kingdom. I am a mobilized member. I commit where you see fit, and my submission and honor to you and loyalty to those over me is undeniable. Thank you, Lord, for speaking to me today. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 God bless you. Praise. My eyes closed. And although, you know, you heard the word of God today, and you heard about the different paths of being sanctified, being set apart, it's very difficult to do that without the power of God in your life. So I want to invite you today to connect to the word that He sent His only Son, Jesus Christ, to God on the cross for your sins, and then raise Him up in power so you can live an abundant life. And so, there anyone here, we don't want to take for granted that everyone in here is saved, or you want to rededicate your life to the Lord because you realize that you've been maybe one of those ones that's been living an unsanctified life, an unset-apart life. You've been kind of doing your own thing. There's no judgment here. We've all been there before. And so, I want to give you that opportunity to give your life to the Lord for the first time, or rededicate your life for maybe the first, second, maybe third, or even fourth time. It's not about how many times. It's about the matter of your heart. God doesn't look at you and say, well, you did this 2 years ago. You did this a year ago. All God wants to know is that with the sincerity of your heart, you want to reconnect with Him, and He's ready to receive you. So again, while everybody's eyes are closed and every believer is praying, I just want to ask that you can raise your hand. We're going to all pray a prayer together. I'm not going to ask you to come forward or anything like that or call you out. But if that's you, if you raise your hand so I can recognize you, and we can pray a prayer together. Amen. A prayer of salvation and rededication. Amen. Is there anyone here? We want to make sure we pray with you today before you leave. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I believe we are all family. So I'm going to ask those of you who are in here today, that were you blessed by the worship and word of the Lord? Amen. Spend time in the presence of God and to obey God and to allow God to do what He did. I'm declaring that your family members are set free from addictions. I'm declaring in the name of Jesus. I want to hear the praise report. I'm expecting the praise reports to come forward. I'm expecting that. So I want to hear from you. When those things begin to happen and you begin to see those changes, I want you to begin to share with me. But call those family members out each day and thank Him for what He did here at the altar today. Amen. Amen. Well, God bless you. I thank God for you. Those of you who are going to the West location at the Sheraton, you will be there at 11 a.m. Sheraton, Novi, and Emma. Don't forget, we're here at 10 a.m. next week. If you want to see where you sit now, I suggest you be there on time. Amen. God bless you. Let's just pray. Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you. I praise you, Lord God, for this day and day. I thank you and praise you, Lord God, for, all of the hearts of your people. I thank you for the love that you have for us, Lord God. Father, I ask that you bless each and every person as they go. In Jesus' name, we pray in grace. Amen. God bless you. We love you. And I will see you.
Thank you for watching. We hope today's message has been life-changing. For updates and announcements, and whenever you are in the Detroit area, text DWC to 54244. That's 54244. Detroit Worship Center, where we love, liberate, and lead.